And thanks, organizers. Now I will, especially Sueli, who did, and her office, they did a lot for our enjoyment. So I will speak about this question. Actually, so this is something we discussed already in the breaks. So what happens if we take the Hitchin space, the Hitchin metric, on the character variety of representations from P1 of a Riemann surface, so it's M, dimension of M is 2, and M is compact. So you take the character variety, which is homomorphisms from here to, say, SL2 or PSL2C, quotient by PSL2C. Well, if you restrict yourself to maps with Zariski dense image, this will be already hyperkähler. I will explain what it is, but by Hitchin it has some certain interesting metric, and the question is how much this hyperkähler manifold depends on the complex structure on M. A priori it does. But in fact, it doesn't, and this is the point of today's talk. Well, it's slightly, I'm slightly over, I mean, 10 something slightly stronger than what I mean, but it's almost true. Okay, so first, of course, we should do linear algebra as usual. I would speak about complex structures, and complex structures is maps from TM to TM. I square is minus identity. This then you have, if your M is bigger dimension than one, you have to add some extra assumption of integrability, but mostly we won't. What the only thing I need from this slide is that there's another interpretation of this operator that you can take T10 of M inside TM. This is eigenspace of I, eigenvalue equal to square of minus one. And if you have such an eigenspace, you can recover your complex structure by doing T01 of M is T10 bar, and then you write your complex structure by writing block matrix square of minus one minus square of minus one zero zero. Here you have T10. Here you have T01. So the complex structures are identified by a certain open part in a Grassmann in a Grassmannian. The open condition which you need is that T10 plus or intersected with T10 bar is zero. And of course, if you take the direct sum, this should be the whole space Tm times C. Okay. So before I start on telling you this hyperkähler story, I wanted to tell about Heyer-Techmuller spaces. it's a funny story. I'm not going to use it, but I like it extremely, and this was what motivated me for the rest of the subject. And it is fairly obscure. I think nobody did it except Fock, but it's very nice definition of Heyer-Techmuller geometry. Usually you say about Hitchin spaces and Hitchin components and stuff, and he has an interpretation of Heyer-Techmuller in terms of the certain geometric structure. So I would try to tell you about this geometric structure. What we have is there's a notion, so we start with a flat space C2, which is we obtain as real vector space, two-dimensional times over R with C. So it's the same as two-dimensional vectors, complex vector space with anti-complex involution. And then you consider it as a complex manifold, and you can, this is the ring of holomorphic functions, and inside, or sheaf if you like, and inside this sheaf you have an ideal sheaf. So this is ideal, or ideal just inside the ring if you don't like sheaves. Then you can take a quotient. Generally, of course, it would be infinite dimensional over C, but it could be fine dimensional. So we assume the dimension of this quotient is equal n, and we consider the set of such ideals. In fact, it's a variety of such ideals. There's a standard way from algebraic geometry to equip this variety with this set with structure of variety. This is called Hilbert scheme. So this is the set of such ideals of C2, the set of such ideals. Okay, but this quotient is a, well, now I have to say it's a sheaf because it has support. So if you take an small open set in C2, then this I would probably be equal to just the ring of functions. The quotient will be trivial. But there's a finite set where it is not trivial, and in fact, this finite set is n points. There could be some of them with multiplicities, but still there is a map from Hilbert scheme to symmetric power n of C2. This is, if you like deformation theory, this is like a map from forgetful map from Duardy to Barlier space. You just forget extra data which is provided by having certain points in the same place. Okay, and now what we have is the examples. So the first example. Okay, sim square of C2 is C2, oh, sorry, C2 times C2 by plus minus 1. So this is C2 with double point, and this is just C2. So how you do it, you just sum up to, you have symmetric, like another pair of points in C2. You sum them up, you obtain a point in C2, but then there is ambiguity. You can, in the order, which gives you this plus minus 1. And then Hilp 2 of C2, it's obtained by, so when you have two points which collide, the corresponding ideal gives you like a direction. And this direction, you can interpret it as cotangent space, so it will give you, this will be actually a blow up of this, so it will be C2 times cotangent space to CP1. Notice that it's holomorphically symplectic. This will be important at some point. Yeah, in fact, the whole thing is hyperkeller, but I'm not going to tell that now. I'm going to tell you about the higher Teichmullers. Okay. Then, in fact, you can obtain the Hilbert scheme for every n as a single blow up. Here, it's sort of clear. You have this singular stratum, which is double point of C2, and you blow it up, you obtain this. But the same is true for higher dimension as well. Okay. Now I'm going to give you the definitions. So definition x n of C. Let's start with x n tilde. Okay, I'm going to switch notation slightly. Now I fix V, which is VR times C2, and VR is just R2. I want to make the dependence on the vector space more clear. And then I write xn of v is a set of all points in the Hilbert scheme. Such that support is precisely this map. So it's a support of this x is 0. So this means that you have an ideal which is equal to O, to the, this quotient is trivial outside of 0. This is the same as you just take some ideal which contains quotient by maximal ideal of x to some power. So in this case, for instance, it will be T star of CP1. Okay, but we have something better we need to define. This is an anti-complex involution. So first, obviously, since this is real, you have anti-complex involution. Just complex conjugation, tau from V to V. And of course, it doesn't map holomorphic functions to holomorphic functions, but then you can take complex conjugation. So tau of F bar belongs to O V if F is a holomorphic function, so it's a function in OV. This gives you a certain ideal, starting, if you have, you start with ideal, you end up with ideal. So this gives you involution from Hilb N of V to itself. And then it's clearly preserves zero, so it acts from XN of V to itself. It's anti-complex involution, so it's it doesn't preserve the complex structure, it maps it to an opposite. Okay, and then I define x, so it was x tilde, sorry, it was all of it was x tilde, right? Xn of V is a set of all x inside, so it's an ideal again, in xn of v, such that x plus tau of x, this is our involution, generates maximal ideal of 0. This is a generic condition. And this is called the point, I mean, the point of this this set is called the set of higher complex structures. So definition, xn of v, set of higher complex structures. And everything is due to Fock and Thomas. Structures of order n. Okay, there is this paper, they did it. So if you take x2, this would give you a point in well, if you do x2, do it carefully, this would give you a complex structure for the following reason that the complex structure is defined by direction, and direction is, this is a difference between Hilbert scheme and symmetric power, because Hilbert scheme remembers which direction you came to your point. And then this condition is precisely the condition that I wrote here. So there are two open conditions which guarantee you that you won't have any bad collisions between your ideal and its complex conjugate. Okay, so the idea is to define the space of higher complex structures up to Diffie-Morrison group. The point is, of course, that we're slightly overreaching. The Diffie-Morrison group should also be extended. So the higher Teichmuller, so it's Teich n. This is on the next slide, actually, is complex structures n quotient by diff tilde. This is higher complex structures, and this is higher diffeomorphisms. So what it is? So first, I already defined you the higher complex structures. So we take the set comp n. So we fix a Riemann surface. So fix n is two-dimensional manifold, real manifold, and we consider the space comp n. If you please ask me questions, I would appreciate it a lot if you can. Comp n is a set of all is it like collection? Yeah. So it's a set of all collections. Set of collections of P in xn of t x of m for all x in your m smoothly dependent on x inside m. So what we do, we just defined a higher complex structure. Now we consider a family of higher complex structures in each tangent space to your Riemann surface. Now we want to define the higher diffeomorphisms. It's not hard. So definition. Yeah, please. Thank you very much. Yeah, yeah, here we have, oh, sorry, of course, it should be times C. This is because it takes two-dimensional complex space. So we take, this is real two-dimensional space, we take its complex complexification, and we do this Hilbert scheme game with it. Yeah. Yeah. This open condition. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's almost always. So let me explain you what is a generic, actually what is generic point in a Hilbert scheme. You take a curve inside C2. And you consider the, so let's call it this curve X. You consider your V, which is C2, map to OX. You take the kernel. Kernel is the ideal of x. And then you take ideal of x and take its quotient by certain power of maximal ideal. And if this curve doesn't intersect its complex conjugate around 0, this is your open condition. So it's really like you slightly extend the complex structure to higher jets. This is why it is higher Teichmuller. OK, so higher diffeomorphisms is a space of Hamiltonian. So you have cotangent space, T star of M. This is a real manifold with equivalent symplectic structure. And you take its automorphisms, which are Hamiltonian. So it's Hamiltonian group of Hamiltonian automorphisms of T star of M. And it obviously acts here. Sorry, it should have written T star here. It obviously acts here, and then you take the quotient. So definition, higher Teichmuller is comp n, so it's all higher complex structures up to all higher diffeomorphisms. The funny thing that it works. So they check it for the first, so conjecture, of course. I didn't tell you what works, so conjecture. consider the character variety, so it's a variety of representations, X, on your with the group PSL NR. And this should be equal to Tehen. This is clearly true for complex structures, so when N is 2. But in fact, it's the same dimension. This guy is smooth. It has the same dimension. Second, they checked it you can check it around smaller components, and you can check it for smaller N, like for N equal 3 and 4. At least for 3, they did it. So it seems to be true, and then, it's in this paper which was quoted in the previous, this slide, yeah. Please. No. Of the same dimension, yes. Yeah. Well, I'm not sure they proved contactability, but maybe it's easy. It should be easy because this is a very, I mean, it's already, I don't know. Maybe they proved contractibility, I missed it. But anyway, it's a nice geometric object, which is much easier to assess than Hitchin's component, which is, I think, nobody even defined properly. Okay. So now, this was, for me, it was a motivation. So this is the, Fock worked a bit. So the main problem, this is, the Tehen is not even symplectic. It's not Keller, not hyper-Keller. Well, it shouldn't be hyper-Keller, but one would expect it to be symplectic or pseudo-Keller or something. And of course, if you expect that to have the same property, you would expect that various complex symplectic and so on structures on this space are independent on the choice of your curve. So this gives a, this serves as a motivation. Now we can forget entirely the almost everything I told you. And this serves as a motivation for this conjecture that Fock was kept asking me for several years. So conjecture, X, the character variety for a PSL 2C, the hyperkeller structure on is independent from choices. Essentially from the choice of Keller structure on the curve, or complex structure. This should sort of follow from the general, from this new approach to higher type measures. Okay. Yeah? I was going to prove it. So what I can prove, in fact, that they are isomorphic in a small neighborhood of on quasi-Fuchsian, they are isomorphic on small neighborhood of Fuchsian. On the other hand, by complex, by analytic, they are always real analytic. So by analytic continuation, they would probably isomorphic whenever they are complete. And completeness of Hitchin space is probably no. And I didn't see it anywhere written down, but I expect it to be true. Anyway, so let me to justify that I need at least I should define your hyperkeller manifold. Yeah, you have more questions? Okay, so hyperkeller manifold is a manifold with three complex structures, and by complex structures I understand this automorphism tangent bundle with the metric, which is a Keller with respect to all of them, and they should satisfy quadratic relations ij. Is equal to j minus ji is equal to k. This is just quaternions. And then you have, this is scalar matrix, so you have three symplectic forms, omega I, omega j, omega k, three symplectic forms. So for instance, omega I of xy is equal to g of xiy, and the same with j and k. And then you have, this is actually a holomorphic symplectic manifold, holomorphic symplectic in the sense that you have complex linear symplectic, so mi, holomorphically symplectic in the following sense that you have a holomorphic symplectic form, you write it down explicitly, omega big is omega j plus square of minus one omega k. This is complex valued form, which you would expect because it's holomorphic. It's not hard, it's a simple calculations to check it. Yeah, but, and then you have, in addition to that, you have the whole zoo of complex structures. So if you have A, B, C real numbers, A squared plus B squared plus C squared is one, you have complex structure L, which is I, A, I plus B, J plus C, K. It's complex structure. Structure, which is integrable on M. So you have S2 of complex structures. Okay, in fact, you can glue all these complex structures into what is called twister space. So you have just a product of M times CP1, but then it's fibered over CP1 with the fiber M, but then you put the complex structure in such a way that for each point, you identify this with S2. So this is S2. And for each fiber, the complex structure corresponds to the corresponding quaternion. This is called twister space. So here it's written formally. You just take you decompose your tangent bundle onto direct sum of vertical and horizontal. On vertical, you have the complex structure induced by your point in CP1, and on CP1, you have just standard complex structure. And this is integrable, which is not obvious, but it was proven. In fact, Obata did it in the 50s, and then it was in the PhD thesis of Simon Solomon. Okay, and this is a way, actually twister spaces were invented by Penrose to encode solutions of general relativity in terms of complex geometry, which was very effective. And then these twister spaces can be used to encode the hypercalor properties in terms of complex of properties of your twister space. In fact, you can. So you can recover your hypercalor structure just from complex geometry of the twister space. Okay. So now I'm going to tell you something, some additional structure, which exists on Hitchin's Monlie space. It exists on spaces obtained by hypercalor reduction, but it doesn't exist, for instance, on K3 or a torus. It's called HKLR. This is Hitchin, Kalhede, Lindstrom, Rochek rotation. So first rotation on CP1 is just rotation. Isometries fixing two poles. And then suppose you have U an action on M such that it acts on the set of complex structures, on induced complex structures by rotation. And isometric. This is called HKLR rotation. I will tell you in a moment why it is relevant for Hitchin spaces or Simpson or just character varieties. But you can easily see it in just quaternions. So if you have quaternions, flat quaternions or flat metric, it's a hypercalor manifold, and then you have complex rotation. And if you look how complex rotation acts on the rest of quaternions, then it precisely does what we have. So this is a very natural notion. Okay, and it extends to twisters. So first extends to twisters. Obviously, it acts on by rotations on the fibers. I mean, moving fibers around and rotates the base. And then acts by it fixes two poles. So it fixes two fibers. And on these fibers, it acts holomorphically because it preserves these two fibers, preserves the complex structure. So on fibers, on poles, which I called I and minus I, U1 acts by symplectic homotopies, by symplectic homotopies. And this is a trivial calculation, which I even gave here. So you just look how it rotates I and J and K, and then you use this formula, and you find how it rotates your holomorphic symplectic form, and it maps it by to itself times a number. So it's really homotopies. Okay. And third, there's example. Okay, I didn't tell you, and this is an important historical observation. So hypercalor manifolds were invented by Calabi. Well, the term was invented by Calabi, though it was before, for instance, Abate had it. And Calabi liked it because he had an example, which is cotangent to CPN. The point is that a rotation group, the group of complex rotations un plus 1, acts on this cotangent to CP1 with just cohomogeneity 1. So it has one-dimensional space of orbits. And this means that your matrix are just solutions of a certain map from a line. So it's an ordinary differential equation. And Calabi just solved this equation. And then he found that it is cotangent to CPN is hypercalor, and then, since then, people learned how to obtain it by hypercalor reduction, which is like color, symplectic reduction, but in for quaternions. And then one, you can write this, as I told you, if you have, maybe I didn't, but if you have hypercalor reduction, this U1 action is automatic, and on cotangent space to CPN, U1 acts by rotation, by rotating the tangent space, cotangent. So it fixes the points and it rotates the cotangent vector. In particular, as we would expect for symplectic homotopy, it fixed point set as Lagrangian. Okay. This is always true in a sense, at least what we have is that fixed point set, because it's symplectic homotopy, so the fixed point set is isotropic. It could have any dimension from the zero to middle dimension, but your symplectic form restricted to this fixed point set is always zero. Okay. Now what I wanted to tell you is that this construction of Calabi, in fact, generalizes to all Kähler manifolds. Of course, then you don't have any homogeneity one action, so it's much harder. And it was performed by Kaledin and Birtefix independently. And so what they did is that they found hypercalor structure on cotangent space to any Kähler manifold. In fact, this is an equivalence of categories. But you have to do it properly, you have to use this H-Kähler rotation. Then it will be really equivalence of categories between Kähler and something hyperkähler plus this section. So we need two things. First, we need this rotation, which is automatic in this construction of Kaledin fix. And second, we need also certain condition on weight of the action. The point is that if you have this symplectic homotopy, you can restrict it to a fixed point set, and then around the fixed point set, it can rotate the symplectic form in several different ways. It is called weight. And we want it to be, we want the fixed point set to be weight one, which means that it just rotates it like it would rotate this cotangent to CP1, rotating the tangent vector. So definition, HKLR. So suppose you have a fixed point set. A fixed point set is always smooth because it's compact group. So you have its component, X is hyperkeller with HKL rotation. And say Z is fixed component. Suppose that Z, we know that already that Z is isotropic, but suppose that Z is Lagrangian. Then, so it's not definition, it's claim. A neighborhood, a small neighborhood of Z inside X is identified with Cartesian space. Well, with the neighborhood of Z in T star of Z, and this identification is compatible with Yon action. Identification compatible with U1 action. It's a very natural identification. It's just there's a theorem of Weinstein about neighborhood of Lagrangian vibration, Lagrangian subvariety in symplectic manifold, and Lagrangian submanifold in symplectic manifold. This is precisely like a special case of this theorem. Okay, and the definition Z is weight one fixed point component. Weight one because it acts by U1 acts by weight one in the normal space. It acts trivially, of course, on the Lagrangian submanifold. Now, the theorem of Kaledin fix. Suppose that this notation I use, M is scalar, and X is a small, sufficiently small. You have U1 action on a cotangent bundle, just rotating it, complex rotation. So you have X is small, U1 invariant neighborhood of M inside cotangent space to M. This is complex, so it's a complex neighborhood. Then there exists unique hyperkeller structure on this X, which is compatible with given. So there is a canonical holomorphic symplectic form of Cartesian space. It should be compatible with holomorphic symplectic form with U1. With holomorphic symplectic form and HKLR rotation. Okay, so this is a way of interpreting Keller as hyperkeller and vice versa. You can like translate things from one language to another. It doesn't go that very far, mostly because not many people work with it. Freaks, actually, I think, couldn't find a job and just turned into a doctor, and Kalinin switched to algebra. But then it's still useful, and you will see how I will use it for to prove the conjecture of Fock. Okay, so this construction is categorical in the sense that if you have a morphism like embedding of hyperKeller manifolds or even N-to-1 maps, what we need is that it would be complex analytic and isometric. It will give you the corresponding map of these germs of hyperKeller manifolds in obtained by this theory. Unfortunately, germs. We cannot extend that to the whole cotangent space. Usually, it's just impossible. There are some singularities which are acquired, and nobody has any understanding what happens. So the picture is not very clear, except that you can do it. First, you can do it for symmetric spaces. You can do it for CPN, as Kalabi did. This is an example, of course, of construction of KNFX, what Kalabi did. And then you can do it also for the hyperbolic spaces and see that it acquires singularities. OK. Now what I can finally, OK, before I do it, let me explain the theorem of, theorem which gives you a hyperKeller structure on the character variety. So you can do it in big generality for any semi-simple or even reductive complex Lie group. So I have GC, semi-simple, complex Lie group. You have character variety, so you have M is compact. You don't need compactness for that, but then you have to put some parabolic restrictions on the cusps, and we don't want it. So I assume it's compact, a Riemann surface. So complex structure is already fixed. You consider the character space, the space of representations. It's a space of all homomorphisms. Hom zero means that the image of from P1 of M to GC is Zariski dense. So it's in particular it's irreducible. I think what we irreducibility would be enough already for at least for most purposes by GC. Then it is hyperKeller. Is hyperKeller and has HKLA rotation. So how it works? Oh, well, the idea is that you identify the moduli space of representations with the moduli space of Higgs bundles. So definition, Higgs bundle is a holomorphic bundle equipped with a Higgs field, theta, and then theta belongs to lambda 1 of, so let's assume holomorphic bundle over M, lambda 1 of M times endomorphisms of B, and then you have theta, which theta is equal to 0. So the last, this means that you take a square of theta as a one form, but then you multiply the coefficients. Okay. There is, in fact, a way of doing it smoothly to glue the whole thing together and obtain the twister space. This is probably the easiest way to give hyperKeller structure. This is the one which Simpson likes the most. to obtain a hyper, like you just glue the twister space. You take the what is called lambda connection, lambda connection. So lambda is complex number connection. It has so the symbol of 1 0 part is just d, and the symbol of 0 1 nabla 0 1 part is lambda d bar. Or you can write it explicitly like I did here. And then you have this condition. It has curvature is zero. And you notice that when lambda is zero, this is precisely this condition. Holomorphicity of nabla of theta plus theta square is equal to zero. And then you check that they glue together this. This for non-zero lambda, it's just for representations. I mean, you can always rescale this operator conformally on the non-holomorphic variable and obtain a connection. But then it turns out that it gives you a certain smooth manifold, which is a manifold over, I mean, it's a deformation of a variety over C. The central fiber is non-isomorphic to the rest of the fibers, but C star acts on the rest of the fibers transitively, and you glue it to its complex conjugate using complex conjugation here by identifying this guy with the flat bundles. Okay, this gives you twister space. The point is that in this interpretation, you get this AHKLR rotation for free. It's just rotation. It takes nabla lambda and produces nabla u lambda. By you have nabla lambda is nabla lambda 1 0, which is just a part of connection, plus nabla lambda 0 1, which is this twisted term, and then the corresponding you would just multiply this. So u of this is just this term multiplied by u. So the U1 action is free. And of course, hyperkeller structure is slightly non-free. You will see a bit of it soon, but I mean, especially the metric is non-free because what we did is, of course, only complex structures. Okay. Now, this, in particular, on the central fiber, you have a C star action, which just multiplies your Higgs field by a number. It's not a complicated C star action. So you have U1 acts on B theta by mapping it to B U theta. Okay, and the important thing, this is why Hitchin actually, Simpson actually needed it. So originally he did his PhD under Wilfred Schmidt, and who was the biggest specialist in variation of Hodge structures. And so he wanted to interpret Hodge structures in certain like reasonable terms, less artificial than they were defined in. And he found that, in fact, you have this canonical U1 action on character variety, and fixed point of U1 action are precisely variation of Hodge structures. I will tell more about this if I have time. Okay, but this U1 action is really like crucial for the whole business. Okay, now I can tell you this result, which I The problem with this result, which I was trying to interest Biswas and Mahan Mitra with it, but then as we were very close to starting writing, it appeared in print in slightly different terms. So they dropped this project, and I sort of dropped, but then I spoke with Falk, and he told that he doesn't understand what is in there, and he wants me to explain it in more down-to-earth terms. So theorem. You have a fixed point component of U1 action, action on, now we have character varieties. M is a Riemann surface of G, genus bigger than 1. We take character varieties associated with PSL2, 2C. One of them is take. And then hyperkähler metric on a neighborhood of take inside this character variety, 2C is independent from the choices like complex structure on M, on M, and then the hyperkähler metric restricted to the Teichmüller space. So this Hitchin metric, in fact, restricted to Teichmüller space, is Weyl-Petersen. So now we can construct this Hitchin space using Kaledin Fakes theorem very easily. We start with the Teichmüller space. We put Weyl-Petersen metric on it. Weyl-Petersen metric is the following object. You identify tangent space to a curve, to a Teichmüller space in this curve with first cohomology of tangent space to this curve. The curve has a canonical negative curve metric, which gives you a identify H1 with harmonic representatives, and then you just take the norm of this, like Euclidean norm, L2 norm of the harmonic representatives. So it's really intrinsic Kähler metric. You can, in fact, define it on any deformation space of whatever you like, and it's entirely independent on any choices. Then you can apply Kalin Fakes theorem to this metric, and you will obtain a certain neighborhood of Teichmüller inside of cotangent space, which is hyperkähler. Then you can try to extend your hyperkähler metric by analytic continuation until you stuck with some, either it becomes complete or you're stuck with a pole, and this would give you Hitchin space. Okay. Do you have any questions? Because I know I'm going to explain how it is proven, and it's better to have any questions now because the proof is compressed. I think it was neighborhood, but I'm not sure. Yeah, it's around Fuchsian. I'm not sure it can be extended to the whole thing. You think it can be? It's. Yeah, I should check. You're right, I should check. The point is, I never actually read the Donaldson's. So it was. Then I didn't read it, then I read this paper, and he refers to Donaldson, and then I forgot to read Donaldson, sorry. Okay, but I think, he doesn't say it's the whole thing. But it should be the whole thing, because, I mean, the Hitchin metric is it. So in the end, you obtain the whole Hitchin metric by this construction. Okay. Now let me first explain how the scheme of the proof. It's not hard. So first we prove that this Teichmüller is Lagrangian here. I mean, it's sort of obvious what you have to show, that it is fixed point set. Then dimension, didn't count the dimensions. Dimension is sort of easily seen to be half of the, so it's, and then you have to explain why Yuan action preserves this Techmelot. This is the first. And then you have to prove, of course, that the hyperkeller metric of Hitchin restricts to Teichmuller, given your Weyl-Petersen. So this is two steps you have to perform. Then it immediately follows, because you just apply Kalin fix, you check that it is Lagrangian, you have your rotation, and if the metric on Teich is Weyl-Petersen, it's independent, so you really have isomorphisms for all different Hitchin spaces. So I have a feeling that Fock expects something similar for even higher dimension of Teichmuller spaces, and then it's completely unclear to me how it works. But here, at least, it's not hard, comparingly. Okay, so I should remind you what is Fuchsian representation. I think we had it a lot on this conference. So it's just a map from representation of SL2R inside. So you have a P1 of M is mapped into SL2R or PSL2R. And this is mapped into P SL to C, and then you identify this with SO or PSO, well, SO, SO plus, kind of component of 1,4, or 1,3. And this is, of course, isometries, again, connected component of isometries, of three-dimensional ball or three-dimensional hyperbolic space. And then you can do as you people always do for any such representation. You define the limit set. So let's call this G, as in Martin's lectures. LG is a limit set. And omega G is its complement, is a discontinuity domain. So it's CP1, So limit set, you take all orbits of all points, and you take their all sets of the limits on the boundary of the ball, which is CP1. And then you take its complement to the limit set to LG, and this is discontinuity domain. Okay, and so for our Fuchsian representation, this is just a middle circle. This is an equator, and the discontinuity domains are upper and lower disks, half planes, and then it acts in a standard way in this upper and lower half planes, and you obtain the quotients will be your curve which you start from. But then you can start deforming it. And so definition, so let's call this rho, or G, you can call this G. G is quasi-Fuchsian if the corresponding limit set is Jordan curve. This is an open condition. Obviously, it's not obvious, of course. It's hard. And then on this, you remove this, again, this Jordan curve. You obtain two upper and lower halves of your CP1, which will give you, after you take a quotient, two curves. So here it was one curve, well, curve and its complex conjugate. But now you will have two curves. And this gives you a map. So you have a map from quasi-Fuchsian representations to a product of two Teichmullers. The second Teichmuller is with the complex conjugate because it's lower half. Well, doesn't matter. Anyway, the theorem is that it is an isomorphism, well, diffeomorphism. This bears information theorem, I think it was mentioned a couple of times. Of course, this means that your quasi-Fuchsian part, which is Teichmuller, I mean, why it is Teichmuller, this is because it can take this discontinuity domain and gives you a point and sort of clearly one-to-one correspondence, I mean, point in Teichmuller. So it has half dimension. This is sort of clear now. Now we need to see how it is related with the with rotation. We want to show that it is, we prove that it's half dimensional, but we want to show that it is fixed point set. And this is, it was actually sort of known since a dissertation, since thesis of, well, probably since Hitchin. I define Hodge structure. Hodge structure is the decomposition of a vector space onto PQ parts, which has the same nice properties as just decomposition of cohomology. So you have VPQ is VPQ bar is VQP, commutative conjugation. So your vector space has a real structure. So we start with something like real cohomology, you quantify them, obtain Hodge decomposition, and we want to have polarization. Polarization is something which comes from Keller structure on your manifold. In fact, you have it on the primitive part of cohomology. Okay, so this is just data of linear algebra, very simple. Just PQ decomposition and this. Now we have variation of Hodge structures. Variations of Hodge structures is, when you have a flat bundle with the real structure and the polarization preserved by the connection. So maybe I should spend some time on that. So I have a flat real polarized vector bound. By polarized, I mean that it is equipped with a certain pseudo-Riemannian, pseudo-Euclidean structure. Non-degenerate, bilinear, symmetric on skew symmetric depending on the parity. Like in the previous, this is actually can be symmetric on anti-symmetric depending on parity of P plus Q. If it's called weight, and I think it's here, W. Okay, so I have B flat BR, flat real vector bundle. You have B is BR times C. You have B is direct sum of BPQ with P plus Q is equal to W. Then you have these properties. The most important property is, so it's definition of variation of Hodge structures. The most important property is Griffith's transversality, which says that you apply nabla BPQ and this nabla 1,0, for instance, so it's you take 1,0 part of the connection, it lies in BPQ plus BP, so it should increase the second index, minus 1, Q plus 1. The idea is very simple. If you do it with cohomology, this is just, so this is the connection cohomology, you can obtain it by taking Lie derivatives, but then Lie derivatives along holomorphic vectors don't change the type very much by Cartan formula. So differential of something of type PQ is P plus 1 Q plus Q, Q plus 1 plus P Q plus 1. So this is why it holds, but this has many implications. In particular, if you take direct sum of P, B, PQ with Q less than some number K, this is holomorphic. So you have a variation of Hodge structure give you a holomorphic flag of subbundles. Okay, but we're interested only in variation of Hodge structures where two, both dimensions is R1, then it is even easier. So the Simpson theorem says that you have a unique, so suppose you have a point in character variety. Then you have a unique, not more than one, variation of Hodge structure on it. And it can be equipped with variational Hodge taxis if and only if it is U1 invariant. So we want to prove that Teich-Muller is U1 invariant, we have to equip the Fuchsian representation with variational Hodge structures. And it is not hard because, okay, we already have most data. We have, since it's real, we have the real structure. Since it is using the isomorphism between PU11 and PSL2R, we have the polarization. The only non-trivial thing is the flag, the holomorphic subbundle. And to have a holomorphic subbundle, you use harmonic theory. Well, theory of harmonic maps. So the idea is that, okay. So we have considered the space of all Hodge structures on a given vector space. Of course, there are some combinatorial data like dimensions, but fix the combinatorial data. Then you would have a certain homogeneous space. And this, well, not maybe not homogeneous, but definitely it's a part of Grassmannian. And it's a partial flex with certain additional properties which are dictated by the sign of polarization. And then the Hodge structure is, if you have a flat bundle, you can trivialize it on a universal covering. And this this would, if you have a variation of Hodge structure, this would give you a map from the universal covering to the set of all Hodge structures, which is called period map. And the set of Hodge structures is called period space. So if you want to find a certain variation of Hodge structure on a given representation, you need to find a map from your, like equivalent map from your universal cover of your map to the space of, to the period space. The good thing about period space is it's negatively curved. For our case, it's just negatively curved because it's a ball. I mean, to find, you need to find just one-dimensional subspace in a two-dimensional space, and then you have a polarization condition which restricts you to a disk. So it's definitely negatively curved. But it is generally negatively curved in some directions, and this is the only directions you can you're allowed to go by Griffiths and society. So that you can do it more generally. Okay, and there's a theorem. Well, it's the next slide, but there's a theorem of Carlet, which says that if you have a flat bundle, I mean, you have a fibration, you have a Erdmann connection, you have, which is flat, and the fibers are negatively curved, you have a unique holomorphic section. And this is how Simpson proves this theorem, that there is a variation of Hodge structure associated with this guy. So you just, we already almost done. What we need to find is a certain holomorphic section from holomorphic equivalent section from our base to the set of to the period space to the set of to a disk. Disk is negatively curved, so it exists. Okay. In fact, this is how you do an uniformization theorem due to Simpson. There is a proof of Simpson, by Simpson of uniformization theorem, which he proved that you can do it using variation of Hodge structures, in fact, using the Higgs fields, so Higgs bundles. So he starts with a curve, and he writes, the following funny Higgs bundle. You take square root of canonical bundle. You have direct sum with square root of canonical bundle minus 1. And then your theta, it takes the first, it maps square root of k minus 1 times canonical bundle to k, square root of k. So it is this kind of map, nilpotent, and which is good because we want something nilpotent. Yeah, so fixed point set, they correspond to nilpotent, to fixed fields with nilpotent coefficients. Okay, so this is the identification between Teichmüller's and the Hitchin component. Okay, so now let me do it slightly more generally, because we need, so to define the Hitchin metric, you really have to see how the proof works. And the proof of equivalence between Higgs fields and the flat bundles is performed by using the harmonic maps. So what is harmonic map? Definition. You have a map F from one Riemannian manifold to another. You write the harmonic energy by taking integral over M. Then you take absolute value of D. It was phi here, right? Phi of d phi squared, and now times volume of M. This makes sense because I think it's Riemannian. Okay, there are two good things about this situation. First, holomorphic are between Keller manifolds are harmonic. Second, if you have, it's converse is also true. If you have a harmonic map between from a Keller manifold to some other Keller manifold, and you have need two conditions. First, it is submersive on some point, and second, that the second manifold has negative curvature, which is true for our case, then it is either holomorphic or anti-holomorphic. And this approach was used by Carlet. So it's a very nice theorem, very general. Well, I stated in more general version than it has, but in fact, this is what he proved. So you have a compact Riemannian manifold. Well, it could be compact Keller as well. You have a fibration equipped with flat Arisman connection. So your all fibers are identified by a connection which is flat. And then you have the fibers are equipped with complete metric with negative curvature. By the way, for the case of CO, the negative curvature condition is much stronger than usual, I would expect. But anyway, you have complete metric which is negative curved. Then there is a unique harmonic section. So if we apply that to our situation, when you have a bundle of disks, there is a unique harmonic section. Well, unfortunately, it's not always holomorphic in our case. So entirely, well, this is how you recover the Hodge. This is how you recover the variation of Hodge structures on the Fuchsian representations. You apply Carlet theorem. But in fact, you can apply it for a bigger generality by finding a certain canonical metric with each representation, with each element of the character, with each representation. So the idea that the space of metrics is in fact negatively curved. So you apply that and you obtain what is called harmonic metric, which is a metric which minimizes the energy functional. So for each element of the character variety, you have a canonical metric associated with it. And yeah. Then what you do to obtain hyperkeller structures, you take a certain part of this harmonic, you take derivative of this harmonic map, and some part of it is actually holomorphic, essentially by the same reason as CU, by the same arguments as CU used to prove that every harmonic map between Keller manifolds is holomorphic. And this would give you the Higgs field. We are not interested in Higgs field. We are interested in the metric, in the Hitchin metric. And there is a very nice way of recovering Hitchin metric from the rotation. So the point is, this is something you have like very generally for each hypercalorie manifold with HKLR rotation. That let's take, okay, we have rotation on its complex isometry, so it's symplectic, symplectomorphism of the over one of the poles, over the variety which is a fixed point pole of your rotation. This means that you can find its moment map, at least locally, maybe globally. Let's take its moment map. It turns out that this moment map gives you a Keller potential, but for another complex structure. So the middle complex structures are actually Stein. They have this Keller potential, which is associated with the moment map for rotation of the poles. If you think of character variety, it's very natural that there's the they're complex geometrically, they are Stein, but the two poles, which are space of Higgs bundles, they're not really Stein. They have complicated geometry. OK. This means that you can take just DD bar, essentially as second variation of your moment map. Let's find this moment map. It turns out that this moment map is just harmonic energy of this section. You take, it's not hard to check, you just, I mean, the moment maps can be written very explicitly if your space is affine and the space of connections is affine. So it's just integral of a curvature. And then if you look what is a curvature, it's precisely the energy of harmonic map. Okay, so now we obtained that the Keller potential of the Hitchin metric is just directly harmonic energy. And what it is actually, geometrically it's the following following object. So for each quasi-function representation, you associate two curves, two points in the Tachmuller space. You run harmonic map from the first to the second. It's not holomorphic, but it is. It minimizes harmonic functional, and this is your energy. So for each quasi-function representation, you have a certain function. And then you take a second variation of this function around take, and you apply a theorem of Yost, who proved that, in fact, this second variation is Weyl-Petersen metric. So this means that after all this identification, we didn't lose or gain anything. So all intermediate terms use the complex structure on your curve a lot, complex geometry, moment maps, and so on. But in the end, you obtain just Weyl-Petersen because harmonic energy is a very nice functional, which is, well, which can be used. I'm done. Thank you very much. And